Item number, SCP-10. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. The objects comprising SCP-10 are to be kept in numbered locked boxes in a high security facility. They are not to be worn except by test subjects. SCP-10 are only to be removed from storage for testing. Description: SCP-10 consists of a series of 6 apparently identical cast iron collars with numbered metal tags and 1 remote control. The control is SCP-10-1. The collars are SCP-10-2 through 10-7. The collars contain intricate electronic components and are powered by small, 5mm in diameter, 2mm thick 100-volt batteries. These batteries are rechargeable. The remote is a heavy black box, resembling an old-style handheld radio transmitter receiver with a primitive blue and white cathode ray screen and a series of more than 100 unlabeled buttons, as well as a frequency tuner. Through trial and error, the frequencies of all 6 currently found collars have been discovered. A label in Russian is stamped into the metal, along with a logo consisting of workers building a pyramid. No official Russian corporation or government agency uses this logo, or matches the words stamped into the metal. Placing the collar around the neck of a person and securing it allows one to control their every movement with the remote. It is also capable of producing an adrenal response and activating or deactivating the sympathetic nervous system. The most abnormal feature of the collars is the effect they have on the body morphology. They allow the user of the remote to reconfigure the shape of the victim to an extent that is apparently only limited by the knowledge of the programming language of the remote. Addendum 10-1, History. SCP-10 was discovered in the basement of a lone man in the Midwestern United States after a local disappearance was connected to him. When the police raided the man's house, they found SCP-10 as well as several dead bodies. One of the bodies was identified to be the man. The others were several other missing persons. Cause of death seemed to be mass suicide. However, there were signs of significant struggle first. Addendum 10-2. Disassemble experiment. Test 1. SCP-10-2 taken apart piecewise. The parts labeled and several photographs taken, then reassembled. Result: after reassembly, SCP-10-2 continues to function. Test 2. SCP-10-8 constructed identically to SCP-10-2, but with the closest approximations available to the unreplicable components. Result: SCP-10-8 fails to function. Test 3. Unreplicable components from SCP-10-2 placed into proper locations on SCP-10-8. Result: SCP-10-2 ceases functioning with removal of components. SCP-10-8 begins functioning. Test 4. Components returned to SCP-10-2. Replicable components in SCP-10-2 replaced randomly with replicas. Result: SCP-10-2 begins functioning with return of components. Changing replicable components for replicas does not significantly reduce functionality. Replacement of a damaged transistor decreased time from transmission to effect of SCP-10-2, response to commands entered in the remote, by 12%. Addendum 10-3. SCP-10 has been demonstrated to work more effectively in creating unskilled labor than for any other task. The logo is apt. Item number, SCP-027. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. The host of SCP-027, currently subject 027-02, is to be kept in a 5-meter by 5-meter containment cell with a grated, raised floor connected to a strong vacuum system. All creatures removed from the subject's containment cell are to be incinerated, except for a small portion to be diverted for analysis and necropsy. The cell is to be cleaned and inspected for structural damage daily. Subject 027-02 must be monitored by at least 2 personnel at all times. Any unusual behavior or vital signs on the part of the subject, or the appearance of any unusual species in the subject's vicinity, must be immediately reported to Level 4 personnel. Security personnel assigned to SCP-027 must be inoculated against all known animal-borne pathogens, and must be armed with tranquilizer guns, with standing orders to subdue the subject if the need arises. Until SCP-027 is better understood, no personnel of Level 4 clearance or higher should approach within 200 meters of the subject. Description: SCP-027 appears to be a phenomenon of unknown source that seems to be tied to one human subject, currently 027-02, at a time. As a host to SCP-027, subject 027-02 is constantly surrounded by swarming vermin that are drawn to his location. The subject does not appear to be able to assert control over these creatures in any way, and is in fact prone to occasional attacks from feral specimens. These creatures have also been known to attack personnel who approach too closely. Wherever the subject goes, an initial swarm of flying insects, such as gnats and flies, will start to form a cloud around him, usually within 2 to 3 minutes. Shortly thereafter, crawling animals, including lice, cockroaches, worms, spiders, data expunged, mice, and rats, will begin to appear. The longer the subject remains in a location, the more vermin will gather there. When the subject leaves a location, some of these creatures will follow, but most will disperse. SCP-027 has been known to transfer between hosts once, upon the death of the first known host, subject 027-01. Since SCP-027 could likely repeat this feat upon the death of subject 027-02, all high-value personnel should be kept far away from the current host until more about SCP-027 is understood. SCP-027 has also likely transferred between hosts an unknown number of times before containment. Research into potential previous hosts has commenced, with preliminary evidence suggesting that SCP-027 may have existed for at least years. It is not yet known how SCP-027 chooses or attracts animals, or even what SCP-027 exactly is. The previous host never expressed having any sort of communication with a separate conscious entity. Analysis of the current host has been inconclusive at best. Appendix 1. Timeline of significant events. April 1990. Subject 027-01 is discovered in an abandoned warehouse outside that had been completely overrun by rats, cockroaches, and other vermin, and is contained and cataloged as SCP-027. The subject is described as a Caucasian male in his late 30s, of average height, but gaunt, filthy, and covered in bites and scratches. The subject also shows symptoms of degraded mental health, evidence of heavy use of alcohol and illicit drugs, and signs of prolonged sleep deprivation. October 2000. Subject expires. Autopsy shows more than 70% of the subject's body data expunged, a colony of rats nesting in the subject's abdomen for at least generations. October 2000. Between 140 and 150 hours after the subject's death, Security Officer reports being awoken by breathing problems due to a large housefly having crawled up his nose, later shown to have laid eggs. Subsequent observations led to categorization of Officer Subject 027-02. The original host is reclassified as Subject 027-01, and SCP-027 is redefined. Data expunged. Appendix 2. Transcript of Interview 027-201. The following interview was conducted on October 2000. Shortly after Subject 027-02 was identified and transferred to the containment cell that had housed Subject 027-01, Dr. Jameson. Good morning, Officer Fr. How are you feeling? Subject 027-02. Scared, confused, mostly scared though. J. Understandable. S. And itchy. Feel like I need to shower all the damn time. J. Ah. But what about, inside? Do you feel anything different inside you? Like a presence? S. Thinks and scratches his head. No, I don't think I do. I haven't really noticed anything like that. J. You haven't felt anything different since the original host died, besides the itching? S. No, I can't say I have. J. What about any sort of voices or compulsions? S. Agitated. No, I haven't felt anything except bugs crawling all over me.
feel dirty and scared and... Doc, what about my family? You gotta get this thing out of me so I can see them again. Jay, of course. Going to do everything we can to get 027 out of you. God, I'm sorry, Craig. Note, shortly after this interview took place, Dr. Jameson and several other members of the research team for SCP-027 were transferred to the SCP-1772 project. Item number, SCP-029. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. SCP-029 is to be incarcerated in a Class 5 containment cell. She is to be allowed access to nothing of a physical nature. Her containment cell is to be placed behind a triple airlock to avoid her escape. As a result of Incident 029-34A, SCP-029 is no longer to be fed, as she does not appear to need sustenance to survive. There are to be 3 guards on duty at all times on her cell, and 2 guards on monitor duty. Floodlights have been installed in the walls of the containment chamber, and are to be on at all times. Once a month, the chamber is to be cleaned and checked for defects. Under absolutely no circumstances are any men to encounter SCP-029 in any manner. Any males who do encounter SCP-029 are to be held under Class 3 detention for interviewing before termination. SCP-029 is requested a bed, denied. A blanket, denied. Books, denied. Clothes, denied. This is ridiculous. The girl can't even have clothes. We are not animals. Let her cover herself. Dr. Erica Bodine. Dr. Bodine, you are granted permission to deliver clothes to SCP-029. Dr. Light. As of Incident 029-53B, anyone who has potential access to SCP-029 is required to first watch surveillance tape 029 Bodine as a reminder of threats involved when working with SCP items and SCP-029 in particular. Description: SCP-029 appears to be a pubescent female of Asiatic Indian descent. She appears to suffer from alopecia universalis. Over 80% of her pigmentation is a true black, while the rest of her skin has a complete lack of melanin, to the point of albinism. Her eyes are also a dark black in color. SCP-029 has severe homicidal tendencies, and has displayed a remarkable ability to use any item as a weapon. However, she has a severe compulsion against shedding blood, preferring instead to strangle her victims. SCP-029 has demonstrated dexterity and physical reactions 4 times as fast as the average human. SCP-029 has also displayed extensive resistance to damage of all forms. Both of these extra-human abilities are greatly hampered in the presences of bright or direct light, natural or artificial. In addition, any males who come within the presence of SCP-029, an area defined by her current perception, find themselves pliant to her will. Such males become willing to kill or even die for SCP-029. SCP-029 refers to herself as, which roughly translates to Daughter of Darkness, Daughter of Shadows, or Daughter of Night. Interviews with SCP-029 have proven difficult to conduct due to SCP-029's constant attempts to kill or convert all who speak with her. Over her years of captivity, the black patches on her skin have increased in size. SCP-029 was first brought to the Foundation's attention by an agent working in rural India. An attempt on his life led him to a small cult of men who claimed to be thuggies in service to the daughter. Several weeks of investigation proved that they believed the world to be in the last years of the Kali Yuga, and that by sacrificing 1 million lives to the Daughter of Darkness, they could raise their goddess and end the world. They also believed that only sacrifices performed through strangulation added to this tally. Events led the agent to their mountain fortress, where he discovered SCP-029. After the loss of said agent, data expunged, which ended in our acquisition of SCP-029. Addendum: 7 years after capture, SCP-029 began showing anomalous growth in her black pigmentation. When questioned about it, she claimed her followers were on the move once more. Investigation led us to a concentration of so-called thuggies that had escaped our initial foray. After discovering that all of her followers were there for one of their holy days, a tactical airstrike was called in. When the first bomb dropped, SCP-029 awoke from slumber, screaming at the top of her lungs. SCP-029 continued to scream for the next 4 hours, ranting and raving that we were killing her people. Since said event, the growth of black pigmentation has stopped completely. Also since said event, SCP-029 has redoubled her efforts to escape. SCP-2820 has been proposed as a possible method of neutralization, should this situation worsen. Item Number SCP-046. Object Class Euclid. Special Containment Procedures. The land surrounding SCP-046 has been purchased and surrounded by multiple layers of security, including fencing, barricades, and lethal effect traps. Multiple signs marking the area as private property are to be prominently displayed. The area is to be heavily guarded at all times to prevent access by civilians to SCP-046. All personnel working around or within a 50-kilometer radius of SCP-046 are to undergo rigorous medical testing to ensure the absence of any potentially life-threatening illnesses. Additionally, increased mental health examinations are to be administered to ensure that no personnel inclined or potentially inclined towards self-harm or self-destructive tendencies are allowed within the 50-kilometer radius. Any injured personnel are to be evacuated to a hospital outside of the 50-kilometer zone around SCP-046. All vegetation surrounding SCP-046 is to be destroyed, and all animals attempting to access SCP-046 are to be terminated and destroyed before reaching its outer perimeter. Any personnel showing unusual interest either in SCP-046 or in traveling to the region near SCP-046 are to undergo medical examinations as detailed above. Any modification to these containment procedures are to be approved by O5 Command before being added to this containment document. Any personnel attempting to modify this document without appropriate authorization are to be demoted and reassigned. Description: SCP-046 is a predatory botanical mass located in southwestern Kentucky. SCP-046 is composed of two parts. SCP-046-1 is a large mass of vegetative matter, composed largely of plants indigenous to the region, including Quercus alba, Ilex aquifolium, and Lonicera sempervirens, though several offshoots composed of other plant species are also present. SCP-046-2 is the land in the immediate vicinity of SCP-046-1, extending to a roughly circular area 20 meters in radius from its base. This area is SCP-046's primary feeding area. SCP-046 is capable of attracting prey within a 50-kilometer radius through hallucinogenic means. All evacuations of personnel should carry them outside of this radius to disable SCP-046's effect. Animals, including humans, suffering from potentially life-threatening physical injuries or diseases, or who are afflicted by psychological disorders that induce self-destructive tendencies, feel a powerful compulsion to come to SCP-046-2 and lie in a prostrate position facing SCP-046-1. Individuals lying in such a position are rapidly attacked by an unusually powerful combination of saprophytic organisms and opportunistic infections, including several strains of methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, MRSA, known to induce necrotizing fasciitis, also known as flesh-eating bacteria, a form of fungal spore similar to Stachybotrys chartarum, or black mold, which poisons prey organisms and induces paralysis. And finally, complete consumption by several heretofore unknown species of insect that emerge from the inside of SCP-046-1 during the final stage of feeding. SCP-046 appears to derive nutrition through the complete digestion of affected individuals, particularly larger mammals, such as humans. It is unknown whether SCP-046 is capable of growth. As such, all steps are to be taken to ensure that SCP-046 is deprived of prey until more information is known about its abilities. These efforts are to include terminating individuals prior to their arrival at SCP-046 and disposing of their bodies in a separate location. Addendum 046A. Investigation is ongoing into potential mimetic effects brought about by knowledge of SCP-046 due to anomalous effects demonstrated by certain personnel in response to SCP-046. Access to document 046-07 is restricted to level 4 personnel and above. Item number, SCP-046. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. The land surrounding SCP-046 is to be cordoned off, marked as private property, and surrounded by multiple layers of fencing. The area is to be guarded by no less than 10 guards, though minimal armaments are required. While knowledge of SCP-046 effects is not to be made widely known, personnel afflicted with life-threatening diseases may be permitted to enter SCP-046-2 after psychological screening for self-destructive tendencies. Likewise, D-Class personnel selected for termination may be effectively exposed to SCP-046-2 to facilitate this process. Due to the lack of threat to Foundation security, individuals not employed by the Foundation may be permitted access to SCP-046, though Foundation needs for access take first priority. Description: SCP-046 is composed of two parts. SCP-046-1 is a cylindrical area 5 meters in diameter and 30 meters tall, containing several species of plant matter, including Quercus alba, white oak, Ilex aquifolium, European hollybush, and Lonicera sempervirens, Kentucky honeysuckle, though several offshoots composed of other plant species are also present. No anomalous traits have been detected in the molecular composition of the plants. SCP-046-2 is a clearing of grass extending approximately 20 meters around SCP-046-1. SCP-046's anomalous effects extend principally to animals, including humans, that are threatened by chronic or debilitating illnesses or injuries. SCP-046 is frequently visited by such individuals. Humans of this type report having felt a compulsion to travel to SCP-046's location, often reporting that the location came to them in a dream. Psychological evaluations have consistently shown that such individuals were not previously aware of either the Foundation or SCP-046's specific properties. Individuals feeling this compulsion have all reported having been within a 50-kilometer radius of SCP-046 at the time. This is believed to be the outer range of the object's compulsive range. Individuals who come to SCP-046 consistently describe a dream in which they lie down in the vicinity of SCP-046-1 and rest. Immediately upon entering SCP-046-2, individuals suffering from chronic pain or traumatic mental conditions will describe their symptoms as receding, accompanied by a feeling of calmness, relaxation, and euphoria. Individuals lying down in front of SCP-046-1 will begin to be covered by several vines, similar to runners of Cynodon dactylon plants, also known as Bermuda grass, followed by the apparent sprouting of C. dactylon all over the body. SCP-046 has no compulsive properties, and its effects will only manifest on individuals willing to experience the effects voluntarily. Individuals exposed to SCP-046 will remain communicative until they are no longer visible beneath the grass growing across their bodies. All individuals exposed to SCP-046's effects describe a feeling of peace and serenity, and a happiness that they were able to die pleasantly. SCP-046 appears to fully decompose individuals exposed to its effects within 2 hours, and may or may not use decomposed tissue as a food source. Addendum 046-1. SCP-046 to be reclassified as Euclid, and primary containment document to be rewritten to demonstrate SCP-046's predatory nature by order of O5 Command. Any references to voluntary individuals are to be removed. Description to be rewritten to emphasize volatile and lethal nature of SCP-046 and potential threat thereof. Addendum 046-2. There is no evidence whatsoever that SCP-046 is predatory or has any desire to harm any creature unwilling to expose itself to SCP-046's effects. Suggest original containment procedures be reenacted and voluntary access to SCP-046 continued. No individuals are capable of breaching Foundation security once exposed to SCP-046. As such, there is no reason to deny afflicted individuals the opportunity for relief. Likewise, There is no reason to make this entity seem more hostile than it actually is, aside from a desire to portray every object in Foundation custody as dangerous. Some things must be contained simply because they are strange. Dr. Edward Carter, Head Researcher, SCP-046. Addendum 046-3. Dr. Carter, Principal Researcher for SCP-046, is to be removed from his position and reassigned to the SCP-1250 project. Addendum 046-1 stands by order of O5 Command. Item Number, SCP-051. Object Class, Safe. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-051 and SCP-051-A are to be kept in a sealed containment facility. SCP-051-A is kept within a locked, climate-controlled document box with a viewing window to prevent degradation of its material. Any personnel, with the exception of pregnant or non-sterile female personnel who might not be aware of an early-stage pregnancy, may access SCP-051 as long as a request is placed beforehand and cleared by Site Administration. Description: SCP-051 is a 25-centimeter, or 10-inch, anatomically correct model of a human female, carved out of ivory, with typically Asian features. Microscopic analysis shows that the head hair is human hair. The doll is jointed at the shoulders, hips, and knees. The stomach area of the doll is fully removable as a cap of ivory, exposing a detailed ribcage and organs, and a 2.5-centimeter or 1-inch ivory fetus, connected to the main figure by a leather cord umbilicus. When brought into the presence of a pregnant human female, SCP-051 has various deleterious effects upon the pregnancy, generally resulting in miscarriage of the fetus. Reports include a gentle compulsion to handle the model, open its stomach cap, and take out the fetus. This results in nausea and cramping within 5 minutes, vaginal bleeding that begins as spotting and may progress to hemorrhage within the next half hour, and miscarriage within 2 to 24 hours in most recorded cases. Medical records indicate that the aborted fetuses bear moderate to severe defects. Pregnancies carried to term after exposure to the model have resulted in severely deformed live births, including deaths of the mothers, and infants terminated after birth by the delivering physician. Witnesses to these live births show signs of severe emotional trauma that was alleviated, after Foundation interviews, by administration of a Class A amnestic. SCP-051-A is a fragment of text on rice paper that was discovered with SCP-051. The surviving text is written with plant-derived ink, test-dated to the 12th century, and the characters have been identified as a known early dialect of Japanese. Translation reveals the text is part of a prayer or spell against demons that attack unborn babies. The incantation orders these forces or demons into the model instead of a pregnant woman, and claims to trap them there. However, centuries have degraded the paper and ink, so that the full incantation and instructions, if any, cannot be deciphered. SCP-051 and SCP-051-A were discovered in a box of early Japanese artifacts, delivered anonymously to the Museum in 1938. After 60 years and a number of incidents resulting from contact by female secretaries, researchers, and students, an agent on staff in the museum's archives learned of its properties and obtained it for Foundation study. Interview 051-1. Interviewed: Dr. David Ehrenfeld. Interviewer: Agent. Forward: Dr. Ehrenfeld was the attending physician at the death of Martha R. on January 2, 1942. This interview was conducted off-site, as Dr. Ehrenfeld was a resident of nursing facility. At the time of interview, he was 95 years old and physically infirm, though retaining most of his mental faculties. A Class A amnestic was administered after the interview. Begin log. Interviewer: Thank you for seeing me, Doctor. Dr. Ehrenfeld: You are welcome. I have outlived most people who would care to hear such stories. Then again, they surely would have thought I was telling lies, or slipping into dementia. Now, you may think the same, but at my age, I do not care. Interviewer: Can you tell me what you remember of the events of January 2nd, 1942? Dr. Ehrenfeld: It was an ugly day. Cold and ugly. It can be a wonderful city sometimes, but winter is a bad season. It was late in the evening when my housekeeper told me I had been called. I was tired, but a birth is always a wonderful experience. I thought it would cheer me. I had a nurse with me, but the girl never came back to my office after that night. 15 minutes, perhaps, for the cab to reach the museum from my house? I'm not certain, but I think so. The doorman was waiting for me. He led me to the room where they had poor Mrs. R laid out on a low table covered with some canvas ground cloths, I think, to make her more comfortable. Interviewer, what was her condition when you arrived? Dr. Ehrenfeld. Thinking back now, I should have realized it was very bad. When I was young and had not much experience, she was quiet and only grunted with each contraction. She did not respond when I checked her vital signs and spoke to her. She did not even look at me. There was quite a bit of blood. A gush of it covered my hands as I reached down to begin helping her with the birth. The floor was slick with it underneath her, and the baby had not crowned yet. She was dilated well, and the contractions were quite close together, and this made me fear she may have been having a breech birth. I showed a calm face, though. I did not want to panic my nurse, or the researcher Dr. Merrill, who was nearby, a dignified older man. I believe I wanted to impress him. Interviewer, and then doctor? Dr. Ehrenfeld. I was concerned because of all the blood, that her life was in danger. I told her to push, and she was pushing, and my nurse helped her, putting downward pressure on the abdomen, as I attempted to manually aid the infant's emergence. I will spare you the details of a breech birth procedure. It can be found in any obstetrics manual of the time. I probed blindly and felt, I thought it was a coil of the umbilicus, perhaps tangled around the baby's neck. I almost withdrew, thinking that an episiotomy would be required. But she tore before I could proceed. There was more blood, and the baby began to emerge into my hands. I had never seen such a thing. You are a researcher. Do you know much of the common cephalic birth defects? This was uncommon. I thought at first the infant must be stillborn. Its flesh was gray, not the vernix-covered gray of a normal birth, but lifeless and degraded. The smell of decay. I recoiled, and the poor mother screamed on her last push, and the infant was delivered into my arms with a great rush of hemorrhage. The deformity. Unspeakable. The thoracic cavity was completely open. The limbs. Interviewer, but it wasn't a stillbirth. Dr. Ehrenfeld, it looked at me. I heard the nurse above me, beginning resuscitation attempts, then heard her gasp and falter as she saw what I held, gagging as the smell filled the room. I tried to drop the creature, but it clung to my hands. I felt my skin begin to blister and crack. Strange how clearly I can remember it. At my age, sometimes I cannot even remember what I had for dinner. The infant was almost double the length of a normal, viable fetus at 8 months. Its lower body, segmented. Interviewer, what did you do then? Dr. Ehrenfeld, it began to laugh, and I killed it. I broke its neck while it looked at me. Interviewer, were there ever any questions or consequences? Dr. Ehrenfeld, in 1942, with the country at war, and two respected professional men to give their testimony? No. The museum building had a furnace. I disposed of the infant's body myself. We claimed some more normal defect had taken the lives of mother and child. The husband was a drunkard, and cared for nothing but her life insurance policy. I believe he was drafted shortly thereafter, and died somewhere in France, and I left my practice almost immediately. I never delivered another child. End log. Closing statement. Dr. Ehrenfeld expired 4 months later of pneumonia. Item number, SCP-061. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. The source code for SCP-061 is to be kept on a standard archival quality read-only data compact disk, or CD-ROM. 4 copies of the CD-ROM with the source code are to be stored in separate maximum security inanimate object lockers. Except for purposes of approved experimentation, SCP-061 is not to be loaded, compiled, or run. Research proposals for SCP-061 require written approval from Site Command. Only 1 copy of the CD-ROM containing the source code for SCP-061 may be used at a time. The CD-ROM is to be returned to storage immediately after having been used to load the source code for SCP-061 to a device. SCP-061 must never be loaded, compiled, or run on any device which has a connection to the Internet, either directly or via another device. SCP-061 must never be loaded, compiled, or run on any device which is physically capable of wireless connectivity, regardless of whether that connectivity is in use. For purposes of approved experimentation, SCP-061 may be loaded, compiled, and run on a LAN consisting of no more than 3 devices plus peripherals. No devices are to be disconnected from the LAN during experimentation. Following the conclusion of experimentation, all devices within this LAN are to be immediately reformatted. Audio output peripherals for this LAN are to be contained within an observation chamber, surrounded with noise-canceling vacuum insulation. In the event of a perimeter breach by hostiles during SCP-061 experimentation, all devices within the LAN are to be immediately destroyed. Description: SCP-061 is an acoustic computer program being developed by SCP researchers, with the intent of producing successful countermeasures to similar programs being developed by governments and individuals around the world. Inspired by research on data expunged, SCP Command saw both the potential and harm in the ability to control the brain functions of other human beings. Laymen understand that music can elicit certain emotions and memories, or various sounds can elicit fear and excitement by simply being heard. Governments around the world have been attempting to expand on that premise for decades. SCP research is the first to elicit responses on higher mental activities. Parts of the brain affected by SCP-061 differ from those stimulated by data expunged or by subliminal messaging. Instead of acting on parts of the brain that are thought to be in control of the subconscious, acoustic frequencies produced by SCP-061 intercept conscious thoughts as they are produced and replace them. Instead of a suggestion, the human hearing center bisects the conscious thinking mind of the frontal lobe with a motor control cortical homunculus of the brain. A baseline rhythm convinces the rest of the brain that the conscious mind is asleep and effectively stops conscious thought from continuing to the rest of the brain. In return, the frontal lobe experiences a pause that resembles the psychological effects of anesthesia. Acoustic codes developed by SCP-061 are interpreted by motor centers in the brain as conscious instructions, and the subject typically acts accordingly. Subjects will normally have a blank facial expression while under the influence of SCP-061. They are not responsive to attempts at conversation and express no desires, such as hunger or interest in sexual advances. Though all commands are followed without question, the effects of the auditory control cease once the subject is no longer able to hear the program. Most test subjects report being unable to remember the actions they performed while under control, but a few had experienced the effect of watching helplessly as their body acted against their will. The intent of such research is to discover ways to counteract the effects of auditory mind control. However, only 2 methods of countermeasures have proven successful as of yet. 1. The subject's hearing is impaired so that the individual can no longer hear the program, either by covering the ear or deafening the subject. 2. The program itself sends a coded instruction to the hearing center of the brain, permanently shutting it down. Though the ear continues to hear, there has been no progress in finding the proper code to reboot the hearing center of the brain. Addendum 01. All subjects are placed under auditory control, issued a coded auditory command, and then monitored. Subject 4402F. Command: sleep. Response: subject curled up into a fetal position on the floor, and her brain began emitting alpha waves associated with sleep. Her eyes remained wide open in the typical blank, empty expression associated with controlled subjects, but her eyes twitched rapidly in ways associated with REM sleep. Subject 4427M. Command: run on treadmill. Response: subject mounted treadmill and then proceeded to run. Subject did not turn on the treadmill, resulting in the subject impacting the control platform. Subject repeated this until the stop command was issued. Note: more detailed commands are advised for task-oriented commands. Subject 4427M. Command: turn treadmill on. Run on treadmill. Response: subject turned on the treadmill to maximum speed, mounted, and attempted to run before being ejected off the conveyor belt. Subject repeatedly attempted to turn on the treadmill to a random speed and run on it, with various outcomes. Note: more detailed commands are advised for task-oriented commands. Subject 4427M. Command: turn on treadmill to jogging speed. Jog on treadmill. Response: subject successfully jogged on treadmill until stop command was issued, which resulted in subject being ejected off the conveyor belt. Note: Subject should be in a safe neutral position before stop commands are issued. Item number, SCP-092. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. The 3,125 instances of SCP-092 are to be held in individual cases suitable for containing non-anomalous audio compact discs, or CDs, and stored in standard inanimate object lockers at Site 37. Each instance is to be individually numbered with permanent marker. Testing of instances of SCP-092 is to be done in soundproof rooms. Only one instance of SCP-092 may be examined at a time. Only D-Class personnel are to listen to previously unexamined instances of SCP-092. Research proposals which involve non-D-Class personnel listening to instances of SCP-092 require written approval from Site Command. The cadaver of SCP-092-B is not currently considered anomalous, except by association, and is preserved in the morgue freezer at Site 19. Description. SCP-092 is a set of 3,125 audio CDs, each labeled the absolute, 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 absolute best of the fifth dimension, and marked with the names of the 31 performers who have at various times been part of the American singing group The Fifth Dimension. Each instance of SCP-092, when played in a standard CD player, will produce a distinct anomalous effect upon all individuals within hearing range. The anomalous phenomenon will last 74 minutes, the duration of a standard audio CD, during which time listeners will be unable to leave hearing range, or to shut off the CD player, or otherwise interrupt its function. As well, when the anomalous phenomenon finishes, all surviving listeners will engage in synchronized vocalization of the phrase, "Wow, that was real cool." Synchronized vocalization has been observed in non-anglophones, pre-verbal infants, unconscious individuals, paralyzed individuals, and individuals physically incapable of speech due to laryngeal, lingual, and/or buccal damage. The anomalous properties of each instance of SCP-092 are thematically and conceptually linked to the number 5, dimensions, and/or the members of the fifth dimension. As of 871 instances of SCP-092 have been assessed, and their anomalous properties formally described. Representative sample of documented anomalous properties of instances of SCP-092. Instance SCP-092-28. Anomalous property. Listeners experience quintuple vision for all moving objects. Instance SCP-092-41. Anomalous property. Listeners' bodies exude pentagonal crystals of elemental boron, chemical element number 5. Crystals cease materializing upon conclusion of CD, but do not dematerialize. Instance SCP-092-42. Anomalous property. Listeners' bodies exude pentagonal ingots of elemental manganese, chemical element number 25, or 5 to the power of 2. Ingots cease materializing upon conclusion of CD, but do not dematerialize. Listeners succumb to acute manganese poisoning within 24 hours. Instance SCP-092-43. Anomalous property. Listeners' bodies exude pentagonal nodules of elemental cesium, chemical element number 55. All listeners killed by cesium burns within 8 minutes. Instance SCP-092-79. Anomalous property. Listeners become physiologically 5 years old. Instance SCP-092-80. Anomalous property. Listeners become physiologically 5 months old. Instance SCP-092-81. Anomalous property. Listeners become physiologically 5 weeks old. Instance SCP-092-82. Anomalous property. Listeners become physiologically 5 days old. Instance SCP-092-87. Anomalous property. Listeners spontaneously become 5 months pregnant. Pregnancies spontaneously miscarry upon conclusion of CD. In initial tests, all male listeners succumb to massive internal hemorrhaging within 10 minutes, as do 3 female listeners. Surviving female listeners succumb to organ damage within 4 days. Post-mortem genetic analysis shows that all fetuses were identical and are not related to the listeners. Instance, SCP-092-126. Anomalous property. Listeners experience unbearably painful facial spasms, characterized by constant chewing and biting motions. Symptoms of trigeminal neuralgia, caused by inflammation of the fifth cranial nerve. During initial test, all listeners batter themselves into unconsciousness against walls of testing chamber in attempt to escape the pain. Instance, SCP-092-175. Anomalous property. Listeners' bodies are pentasected radially, producing 5 disconnected segments, which remain alive and mobile. Instance SCP-092-176. Anomalous property. Listeners' bodies are pentasected laterally, producing 5 disconnected segments, which remain alive and mobile. Instance SCP-092-177. Anomalous property. Listeners' bodies are pentasected axially, producing 5 disconnected segments, which remain alive and mobile. Instance SCP-092-200. Anomalous property. Listeners are teleported to a site on the surface of Himalaya, the fifth most massive moon of Jupiter, fifth planet from the sun. Listeners are returned upon conclusion of CD, but succumb to the combined effects of hypothermia, hypoxia, and radiation poisoning within 3 hours. Requests have been made to use SCP-092-200 to send exploration teams equipped with environment suits to Himalaya. Approval is pending. Instance, SCP-092-256. Anomalous property. Listeners are converted into two-dimensional forms. Instance, SCP-092-271. Anomalous property. Listeners spontaneously lose 5 teeth each. Teeth do not regrow after conclusion of CD. Instance, SCP-092-272. Anomalous property. Listeners spontaneously lose all but 5 teeth each. Teeth do not regrow after conclusion of CD. Instance, SCP-092-273. Anomalous property. Listeners spontaneously lose 5 fingernails each. Fingernails do not regrow after conclusion of CD. Instance, SCP-092-274. Anomalous property. Listeners spontaneously lose 5 toenails each. Toenails do not regrow after conclusion of CD. Instance, SCP-092-278. Anomalous property. Listeners spontaneously grow 3 extra eyes each, for a total of 5. Extra eyes do not dematerialize upon conclusion of CD. Eyes are functional, and of the same color as listeners' original eyes. D-0927714, who had lost an eye in a fight prior to entering Foundation custody, grew 4 extra eyes when listening to SCP-092-278. Instance, SCP-092-279. Anomalous property. Listeners experience topological deformation, such that their height becomes the circumference of their waist, and vice versa. Deformation reverts at conclusion of CD. This appears to be an exchange between listeners' dimension of height and dimension of width. Instance, SCP-092-285. Anomalous property. Listeners sneeze 5 times per minute for the duration of the CD. Instance, SCP-092-286. Anomalous property. Listeners belch 5 times per minute for the duration of the CD. Instance, SCP-092-287. Anomalous property. Listeners hiccup 5 times per minute for the duration of the CD. Instance, SCP-092-288. Anomalous property. Listeners cough 5 times per minute for the duration of the CD. Instance, SCP-092-315. Anomalous property. Listeners find themselves within the 2010 Lars von Trier film Dimension, where they are able to interact with the setting but not affect the actions of the characters. Since Dimension is only 27 minutes in duration, the events within the film repeat 2.74 times. Instance SCP-092-316. Listeners find themselves within the 1993 EastEnders Doctor Who crossover, Dimensions in Time, where they are able to interact with the setting but not affect the actions of the characters. Since the two parts of dimensions and time are only 13 minutes in total duration, the events within the episodes repeat 5.69 times. Instance, SCP-092-317. Anomalous property. Listeners find themselves within the 1963 Italian film Amore in Quattro Dimensioni, where they are able to interact with the setting but not affect the actions of the characters. Instance, SCP-092-397. Anomalous property. Listeners experience random moments in the life of Alan Shepard, the fifth man to walk on the moon. Instance SCP-092-399. Anomalous property. Listeners experience random moments in the life of James Monroe, the fifth president of the United States. Instance SCP-092-400. Anomalous property. Listeners experience random moments in the life of Mackenzie Bowl, the fifth Prime Minister of Canada. Instance, SCP-092-401. Anomalous property. Listeners experience random moments in the life of Edward Sega, the fifth Prime Minister of Jamaica. Instance, SCP-092-402. Anomalous property. Listeners experience random moments in the life of Charan Singh, the fifth Prime Minister of India. Instance, SCP-092-403. Anomalous property. Listeners experience random moments in the life of Helen Hayes, the fifth winner of the Academy Award for Best Actress. Instance, SCP-092-466. Anomalous property. Listeners are physically transformed into members of the original lineup of the fifth dimension, as they were at the time of the group's establishment in 1966. Instance, SCP-092-467. Anomalous property. Listeners are physically transformed into members of the original lineup of the fifth dimension, as they were at the time of the original group's dissolution in 1975. Instance, SCP-092-468. Anomalous property. Listeners are physically transformed into members of the original lineup of the fifth dimension, as they were at the time of the original group's reunion in 1990. Instance, SCP-092-469. Anomalous property. Listeners are physically transformed into members of the original lineup of the fifth dimension, as they are today. Listeners who transform into Ron Townsend, 1933-2001, resume their original forms after conclusion of CD, but do not resurrect. When an instance of SCP-092 is inserted into the CD drive of a personal computer, its files can be accessed without triggering the anomalous effects. Examination of the files indicates that each CD has different content. All content is audio material by, or pertaining to, the fifth dimension and its individual members. In addition to all known commercially released songs, files contain live performances, practice sessions, auditions, media interviews, and personal conversations. Acquisition log. On May 5th, an unidentified man, henceforth SCP-092-B, carrying two suitcases, approached front gate guards at Site 19 and stated that he wished to surrender himself and his anomalous creations into Foundation custody. The contents of his suitcases were confiscated and classed as SCP-092. SCP-092-B was transferred to Site 37 for interrogation. During interrogation, SCP-092-B revealed the thematic connections, five dimensions, and the fifth dimension, between all instances of SCP-092, and then committed suicide. Transcript of statement made by SCP-092-B upon arrival at Site 19. Guard: Sir, this is private property, you can't... SCP-092-B: This is a secret Foundation site, right? Guard: You can't come in here, sir. I... SCP-092-B: You're the SCP Foundation, and I'm a failure. Guard: What was that, sir? SCP-092-B: You're the SCP Foundation, and I'm a failure. I think I'm clever, but I'm not. I'm a stupid, boring, knuckle-turning hack who thinks that money and cheap puns can take the place of talent and inspiration. I'm tasteless. I'm dull. I'm incompetent. I have no sense of style, and the only reason I'm not an art criminal is that nothing I've ever made is even close to being art. You can secure me, and you can contain me, but no one can protect me. Please take me and my anomalous garbage into custody. At this point, guards summoned backup. SCP-092-B repeated this statement verbatim until he was taken into custody. Excerpt from transcript of SCP-092-B interrogation session number 2. Interviewer: Yes, we understand about fiveness, thank you. That's been most helpful. But we were also wondering what you could tell us about how you made these. SCP-092-B: I just wanted to be cool, you know? I really did. I thought, well, I had my inheritance, and my collection, and there was the estate, and the abandoned museum, and so much of the stuff went together, and it wasn't that tough, and... Look, my ideas were better than yours. They were. I know they were. No, they're not. Nobody's impressed by this stupid facile wordplay. It's not even good wordplay. It's kindergarten-level paranomasia. Oh, look, five dimensions. What other things can you think of that come in fives? I'm worthless. I'm worthless. Interviewer: Better than my ideas? SCP-092-B: There's no deeper meaning to what I did. It's all just superficial Potemkin Village crap pumping imitation shit into the river of human achievement. It's Stein's f***ing Oakland, and I don't even f***ing understand those f***ing illusions. I'm an uninspired wannabe. I'm boring. I'm a useless hack with no f***ing imagination. I've wasted and ruined miracles. I've squandered so much raw material that better people could have done so much with. I'm not cool. I never will be. I'm really sorry about the mess. These aren't my arms. At this point, SCP-092-B seized his own head with both hands and ripped it off his neck, killing himself instantly. Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.